ugly. You ever smelled a dead raccoon by the pit? Nice. I don't know if you guys are hearing this, but my audio is all fucking wackadoo. Thanks, Jane or Bob. So Bob's in graphics. Sorry, Bob. Oh, he's the executive producer now? Bob. I know, like, everybody has different seats and things. Like, I don't know. Anyway. I'm sorry. I'm going to turn it down. Man. Hello? Okay. Here it goes. It went. All right. Hello, everyone. Episode 6. I hope everyone's doing well. It has been an exciting week. It's been a tumultuous week. We laughed. We cried. I'm not going to say it was a feel-good event of the week. Actually, no, it was. I think today capped it off. I mean, we had a pretty good week. Anyone that lives in the Philadelphia, Port Richmond, Fishtown area definitely had a good week. All sorts of little projects. You know, before I get too into that, well, actually, you know, we got some time. Let me get into the local news. All right, so we are going to be starting a new interview segment. We've just been working the technical details of that because usually our interviews are done in person, and a lot of our interactions, just like your interactions, are feed off about that need to be there. So we're trying to figure that out. Obviously, video conferencing has been really great. But there's other little nuances, so we're actually trying to figure out, do maybe some interviews we can do in person and just kind of like have sealed areas that are quarantined or whatever, and we're just working different, like, just ways to make that interview really connect. We've got a Harvard lawyer that has lots of opinions. That's an upcoming interviewee. We have a couple of superstar DJs. One of which we are still trying to connect with, but maybe in Isla Boni, some place of dinosaurs apparently hiding off after, like, doing some shit. I don't know. We'll get back to that later. Let's see. We are killing the day in history because fuck this day in history. We have not done well. Two episodes out and it made us feel kind of shitty. So the executive producers and the network executive at the new network, that's the network at the end of the world, our network, the new network, the best network, is killing the segment because this show really is just going to look to the future, and I totally agree. We do have some new segments. Lore Renegade and the visual insanity and beautifulness of our last episode's quarantined artist Stephen Humphrey are going to be presenting some amazing aerialists. So we have our focus on fire artists. So we have this whole other separate performing artist area that is about aerialists, people that perform acrobats and physically in the air using props themselves, like all sorts of concepts. You've probably seen this. It's going to be amazing. I'm really looking forward to that new segment. We also have the Where in the World is Lee Mayjahs segment. So if anyone knows, we have some questions. He has not responded to the emails I never sent him. And I feel awkward because I meant to do and I had all the time because quarantine. Sorry, Lee. I meant to ask you to do that. Anyway, the artist segment is going to be fucking fantastic. We got an amazing artist. We are focusing on Philadelphia. Well, we're always focusing on Philadelphia, but all our Philadelphia artists are kind of have this global impact. But we're going to try a different feature of artists, every different root of artists, because the word artist in our world is very dynamic, and I just realized maybe that's not the same. Maybe someone thinks of an artist as just like one specific skill set or everything. So we're gonna kind of, like, moving forward, go through the different elements of visual, audio, performance, and actually, as all the artists we're gonna be featuring in the next couple weeks, and have actually encompass all those. So that's a really exciting thing. Apparently on the gossip page, the artist Easy Almighty is considering changing his iconic artist brand to accessible but not with due diligent effort. I love it. It's a little wordy. I don't know how he's gonna really push that out. I would love to be on that marketing team and like to have that one go. Like, go team. That's fucking badass. And also this Friday, the Pyramid Cult, I mean Club, will be kicking ass and making triangles during the Burner Feud. So go to the new network this Friday night. I believe it starts at 8 p.m. I think it's two bouts. I don't know any other teams because it doesn't matter because it's Pyramid Cult Club that's going to fix. As above, more below. We are coming. Our party goes in probably, I think, two continents and five cities. So we have a dynamic team as the Pyramid always represents. 3 points, five people, obviously. Anyway, that's about it for the local news. Let's go to the national stuff. Dirty. You had expensive sound system. I'm sorry, but you know, climbed up there. Anyway, day 38. It is day fucking 38 here in Philadelphia. This is not a joke. But 38 days. Does anyone else feel like that? That it was just a little moment of the last week just kind of flew by. I mean, as cliche as that gets, like, we're like, yeah, we're at 30 days of quarantine. All of a sudden, we're 38. I feel like if I blink my eye tonight, I'm going to wake up, it's 132. I speak three other languages now. I can twist myself into a pretzel. Even my neighbor that hated everything has now found something he loves. I don't know. It's fucking crazy, right? But anyway, let's celebrate day 38 with some more coronavirus videos. This one's something special. So just enjoy this one.
Did you wash your hands?
Yeah.
Did you wash your hands?
Yeah.
Did you wash your hands?
Yeah.
Did ya?
Washing my hands.
I did.
Like all day. Touching my face all day. I'm just gonna stay home all day.
Seems pretty normal. A little weird, but pretty normal right now, right? This is guava juice. They make fun content. High quality content.
It's corona time. I'm an influencer, but I don't got influencer, but I'm about to influence ya with this sick flow so ill. But you know the beat is sick of this pandemic. We can end it.
Ladies and gentlemen, if there were any lines to be crossed, this gentleman has crossed them. I did.
Remember to wash your hands. One hand.
I mean, I love the message, so it's hard. The three-hand thing? What is that? Sure, you know. I didn't realize that was a pressing social issue of the three-handed humans being accepted, but hey, I'm into it. Alright, good for the weather.
Pretty good dose of snow in Winter Park. Look at this beautiful shot this afternoon. You can, wow! Yeah, y'all! Yeah, it's gonna be kind of cold today. Temps in the 30s. By tonight, we should see some clearing skies. Alright, you have a good one.
That's right, you deliver the news. Wow. No, but really, the news, got a cool 68. Thank you. 68 degrees. To sports. Right. Sorry, but seriously. So we've just been trying to get funky with sports. All sports, obviously. Since most of it's communal, there's been a lot of individuals being very active and sports and training. I know for myself, I'm as cliche as it sounds. I've been working out a lot just to pass the time, and it's. I'm sure I'm not alone. So I'm trying to keep the sports fun and active because you know we should be keeping our minds and our bodies healthy so we don't start thinking crazy thoughts like We'll get into that later at the special report. Anyway, sports content.
My name is Pat McGee. Today, we're going to test a concept that we have in development, underwater boxing. Female boxers will box underwater, they'll hold their breath, the rounds will be 1 minute, there'll be 3 1-minute rounds, and then eventually we'll have a champion.
Freya doesn't know what she's got coming to her. I think I'm gonna win.
Yeah, I wouldn't try this at home. One punch, and you could die.
No, come on. Yes.
Underwater boxing, it's never been done. There's a reason it's never been done before. It's almost impossible.
Almost? Oh, it's a reality thing. Yeah. All right, that's the end of that plug. But, shout out and kudos to those ladies, because anyone who's boxed, anyone who's been underwater knows that those are two physical feats. Putting those together and having to deal with an obnoxious film crew that's drunk half the time, I can't imagine. So you ladies, rock on. You fucking keep on being awesome. Anyway, now to local news. Is that what we're doing? And there's a lot of local news, let me tell you. Sorry, that lighting. Jane, you're supposed to be on the fucking lighting thing. What is this? If it wasn't for the quarantine, my fucking, like, associate producer Morgan would be here, and you would not be here, Jane. You don't want to deal with Morgan. Once this fucking lighting thing and this whole corona shit, like, just get your Wow, sorry, I know we're live. Sorry. Jane, I'm sorry. Thank you. I appreciate your assistance. Especially considering the fact you're not even real. And I'm just having this dialogue with an entire film crew that doesn't even exist here. I miss my crew. I miss my crew. Anyway, all right. Yeah, yeah. Really exciting stuff we've been doing. So many of the Philadelphia community of creatives are in production, and we do a lot of complicated things on the regular. But the feat that this took, this next little piece took, is like incredible, because it required over 30, 40 people to be at a specific place at a specific time doing specific things, being in contact, being responsive, like, and also dealing with 60 to 80 mile an hour gusts of winds. There was like a whole new level of technical piloting. Basically, what we're doing is we're doing a little montage in Philadelphia, trying to connect everyone. We're doing drone footage. So we've got these really beautiful, very like powerful, very amazing drones that can do amazing things very safely and securely, and get to different places. And everyone's been working about kind of presenting the things. And so I wasn't going to like show it until it's completed and edited, but that's not fair because everyone did an amazing job and there's some beautiful. So we got this little montage for you and we're going to show it to you. The next person. If this somehow develops stalkers, I'm really sorry. I see clowns. Oh, yes, I do. Well, look at this delightful couple. We'll be right back. family project here.
Clearly.
Thank you so much. I love you guys. Look at that beautiful mural. Just for you guys. Just for all of you. Shadow artist extraordinaire. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Again, that was just a rough cut. We're putting that together. We're going to put together a whole little package of all local artists, local music, local video. We're shooting in this Saturday, so if you are in Philadelphia, in our neighborhood, and you want to be part of this, just hit us up. That was just like a fun, quick edit just so you guys could enjoy it and dance around. And just thank you for being part of it, being part of our community, and being part of our neighborhood. This is the tough part.
Damn.
Yeah. You guys, well, I'm just gonna get right into it. So, as you guys all know, in the last episode, superstar DJ Lee Mayjahs was outed. I believe he is currently residing with his family in Isla Bonita, which is the place of the dinosaurs. Is that it? Is that a Madonna song? I'm not really sure, but it's one of those places. Anyway, so after this shocking photograph came out, not that I doubt Lee. I know Lee is awesome and loving and would never release a contagion such as the coronavirus onto the world. But there have been an influx about 9,322 emails I got into my email box about why Lee would do such a thing. And strangely enough, 98%, he wanted to ruin Tawny's birthday. She was supposed to be in Barcelona having the time of her life for her 30th birthday, and that didn't happen. Because apparently Lee decided and said, no, Tawny's not going to have a fantastic birthday. He released the virus. Unfortunately, well, not maybe unfortunately, she got stuck in Philadelphia. And on her birthday, using Protocol 5, which is the highest, most medicinal protective layering, one of her dear friends came to her for her birthday just a few hours ago. This is live from the street. We have that type of technology where we can actually take a camera, run it across like three blocks, and then give it to like some guy with like weird hair, and then you can put it in. It's crazy. But it is a time to celebrate, Tawny. Happy birthday. Thank you so much. You are a huge influential friend in this neighborhood. You do so much for everybody. And it does really suck you have to spend it in this quarantine. But I have a feeling you've got some really good friends. That's right. Don't worry, everyone. I know this is breaking the 6-foot quarantine issue. This is fully protected. I was there. I insulated this lady. This is Alex of the Alexes. Yeah, and she's celebrating her best friend of the year thing. Look at that. She went full dinosaur right there. That was incredible. Thank you so much. Everyone involved in this, Thank you. Thank you. That was fantastic. Don't you want to live in Philly? It's fucking ridiculous. This is like every fucking day, even without a quarantine. Really appreciate that. And now to the weird stuff. Sorry, I was supposed to say that, but it was weird. I was trying to, anyway. So we got some weird stuff, and the whole show's weird. Like we spoke last time, we're trying to figure out what we're going to do with this whole weird stuff moniker, because life is weird, and we love weird. Quentin Tarantino. Tent in Quarantino. Tool are hoping to make a new album while in quarantine. Fuck, I didn't think quarantine was gonna last 12 years! And much like coronavirus testing, those that can afford it is just the same people that can afford to go to a Tool concert, apparently. I don't even know. Look at these ladies, they're having a great time. Coronalisa. Alright, let's leave the fine arts alone for right now. Aww. Just got back from a cruise. Had a great time. Oh, cramps. Fantastic. All right, that is the end of relatively weird stuff. I guess this may be our meme section. I don't know. Viewers, write into us. Let us know how we should integrate these two levels of weirdness. Of maybe not so weirdness? I don't know. You tell me. I don't know. The Artist Spotlight. This is a jam-packed show, people. As you know, we feature nothing but the finest artists, and we do it in a comical, satirical manner, because that's kind of what the show's about, and we don't know what the show's about. We're kind of feeling it out. But anyone that is featured on this show is quantifiably, exponentially an amazing artist, and they've got some work to boot it. You're bored. This is quarantine. Just Google it. You know, like, if you really are having trouble, just, like, contact me. That's, like, you can actually contact me. Just message me on the page, and I'll give you all the feedback. I'll give you an introduction. If you really want me to introduce any of the artists, and you should be introduced because they're amazing. Anyway, this one, this is a good one. We're going for a musical artist in quarantine this time, and Gary Dan, artist in quarantine. Now, it's probably hard for most people who are connected to Philadelphia and the music industry in any shape or form to not know this gentleman. It's hard to be part of Philadelphia in any form move on knowing this gentleman. He is that prolific. You may know World Town. Quantifiably one of the most iconic Philadelphia bands that truly represents its spirit and sound. And Philadelphia's legacy of amazing sound. So to step up to that, and we were talking, that's an exponential shit right there. And the irony is, I am just introducing this amazing musical artist of canned music, and that did not escape me. So we're going to actually go to the next part of this great, like, element, which is he has been giving us the gift of distraction and inspiration. And so every day he's been sharing his kind of hour-long just jam session. He's a percussionist and a musician in trade, as you can see, and this is what he's been doing. This is day 34. Now I want you guys to think about your day 34, and this is this gentleman's 34, and our gift to us. I mean, day 34. Check your day 34. Thank you so much, Gary. Thank you.
you could join us today, because today is a very special day for me. Hi, welcome back. Certainly glad you could join us today, because today is a very special day for me.
I could listen to that for the rest of the show, which would then take several dates, so I could pretty much listen to it forever. Gary, thank you so much for everything that you do. Thank you for the musical gift you bring, but also the space, the safe space. For those of you who don't know, you may have heard of a place called the Boom Room. It's a boutique audio studio and presentation space. So much more than that, really. But it has some of the finest, most intimate gatherings of the highest tier of music. And we are, and a lot of times you just take this stuff for granted because it's just there in your backyard. And you get to spend so much great quality time, and there's so much love there. And you still take it for granted in a weird way. And if anything, not getting to see these people on the regular without a drone is brought that to attention, to my attention. So yeah, so once again, for those of you that know Gary, just give him a shout out and support his art any way you can, and support everyone you can in any way that you can. And for those of you who don't, check out the Boom Room, Philadelphia. Check out Worldtown Sound System. Like, I mean, it's a rabbit hole of amazing art you're gonna go into. Guaranteed. All right, that will bring us to our next exciting new segment. Sorry, your flight has been canceled. Now, first of all, I had a whole silly segment lined up for this that would incorporate, you know, lack of air travel and stuff. But these fine folks gathered media and a little thing together to give me in like less than 12 hours. These were also involved. These fine artists were also involved in the drone footage and helping put that together. So it's pretty amazing we got this done in such a short amount of time. But this little feature, this whole sorry your flight has been canceled, is all featuring of aerial artists, acrobatic artists, and artists that work in the air. Everything from, I mean, we're just gonna get right into it, right? No? Yeah? Yeah? Bob and Jane are arguing, and this is the last thing I need in the live show. Bob, Jane, get it together. We're getting into aerials, all right? Relax. So sorry, I kind of, there's a little commotion here on stage again. But once again, this is not the first, this is not the last by any means. Well, actually, this was the first, but it definitely won't be the last. So we are segmenting, basically, we know so many performing artists that we're not going to group them all together. We're just going to diverge, just become segment to segment, into episode, into completely different programming. Like, this is the birth of a new network. So you guys are used to having your television that you appreciate and things. Well, guess what? There's a new network in town called the Network at the End of the World, and it's just going to start producing and gathering all this content. So if you know any great people that are putting together great content, that are featuring great amazing talent like we just saw in this clip, and like they're focused on like promoting like real people and real artists and real communities, send it to us. Be part of the network. Be sure of it. Anyway, I know I totally went off script, and I don't care. I'm doing it. Ever. Also, Hanover pretzels. Apparently, you're supposed to buy them, eat them, enjoy them. Hanover pretzels. They're dry. Oh, I'm not supposed. They're great. They're dry. They're so dry. I don't know why. They're not great. They're great. I think they're dry. Anyway, speaking of sponsors. I like being left alone. I find I'm pretty good company. Well, if that doesn't sell me to go to the next segment, boom! All right, now we're revisiting this segment. Now, I know a lot of you were a little confused. We're like, the time is now. Well, yes, is that some time meta? Are we trying to, like, is Duncan Trussell going to be on the show next? Like, what is going on? What do you mean by the time is now? Oh.
It is currently 9:10 p.m. Thank you.
It is currently between.
Thank you.
It is currently between 9:10 p.m. It is currently between.
It is currently between
9:10 p.m.
It is currently between 9.
What time is it?
10 p.m.
Nothing. But the most precise.
It is currently between 9 and 10 p.m. Thank you.
And I'm assuming a lot of you.
It is currently between 9 and 10 p.m. Thank you.
I'm probably wondering what the fuck that was. I'm so sorry if the kitties are up. But I felt the word fuck in that regard was like, I mean, that was intense, right? Anyway, so for those of you who don't know, TJ Wow, so we were both OAs, voiceover actors, back in the day, and that's actually how we became friends. And, fuck it, we're just going to get right into the origin story, right? TJ and I, many of you know, he's a dear friend of mine. We have been part of more wedding elements than I can really recall. Like it's a good friendship. Going all the way back to the beginning, where we were both young voiceover actors and we were on an audition competing, and it was fierce. This was like Sony Records was there, everyone was there. This was gonna be the audition to like make or break my voiceover career, or anyone's voiceover career that mattered. I mean, this was it. And it was highly competitive, and I looked over to TJ and he's looked over to me and he's just like, hey Gaëtan, I'm really glad you're here. Good luck today. And I was like, thanks TJ, so do you. This is because he's always been quite a gentleman. So the competitiveness was complicated. But anyway, so at some point I remember the audition, the pressure got told to me, I just kind of blacked out there, and I was like, and then TJ walked off, the microphone, because there was like 12 of us, and it was a very strange audition, and then we just kind of like walked up, and I walked up to the microphone, and it's like, walked up, and I was like, this is the make or break, this is it, this is the moment where I either pay for college, or I get another weird job. I don't know what's going to happen, but it's going to happen. And I walk up, and I've got like my best fucking stage face. I'm like, I'm ready to go. I'm the triple threat. I'm a quadruple. I'm like fucking quintuple. I'm like a superphonic exponential threat at this point. And I'm like, caution, sweeper approaching. And I got the part. To have this, like, ow, like, ow. What finest perfume one can buy. Oh, that was really awesome. Keeps me smelling like a rose. Anyway, that's enough kids and the games. And now to the BKS, the bacon, carrot, and sauce. No, it's the Byron Keats and Shelley Report, the Ravaged Reader's Review. This is our literary element where we go through literary things and discuss literary things and just kind of go through literary things. And of course, our lady in the field, BKS reporter at large, Alexa Lafay. Hey, Alexa, I think we should start maybe with you on camera next time. We'll get to that. Sorry.
Welcome back to the BKS report, where there's no time for buffoonery, knavery or shenanigans. Let's get down to business. I finished reading this book, and to be honest, it wasn't really about any of the stuff that I said it was about. It was just sort of like a regular book. You definitely shouldn't read it. It's, I haven't really been able to sleep more than an hour or two at a time, like every couple days or so, and it's kind of hot in here. That's a little better.
She's got the corona.
I noticed something else. I noticed that the pyramid that came with the book has writing all over it. Writing that only I can seem to see. Can you see the writing on it? If you can, write the show. Write us. Let us know, because I need to know what these letters mean. It's all I can think about. That's gonna be the next thing that I read, and if I like it, I might recommend it. But for now, I can't sleep. And I think it might be because of this book that I read. This book that someone mysteriously sent me, along with a sandwich baggie full of rotting lunch meat and a pyramid. And I can't in good faith recommend this to anyone. That's really all I have to say. And I'm just hoping I can sleep, you know, one of these days. Back to you, Gaëtan. It's just, yeah, back to you.
Well, that kind of went off kilter. That's usually my time to, like, go make a tea, have a sandwich, maybe eat some Marmite. And then, that clearly did not happen that round. Anyway, hope everyone's okay. And no one was hurt. Anyway, now, while following the Academia of Literary, let's go to the Academia of Organic Chemistry into the mixology section.
Welcome back, everyone. Today, I've got a real simple but refreshing cocktail. This is known as the quote-unquote working man's drink. Let's get cracking.
La Paloma is a tequila-based cocktail which has experienced a bit of a renaissance across the U.S., most likely due to record-high tequila consumption. Google searches for this drink have tripled in America over the last 5 years, and rightfully so. It's great. The tequila brand doesn't really matter here, as long as you're sticking with something clear. You'll probably want to stay away from reposados. The next ingredient is traditionally going to be grapefruit soda. I don't have any of that, but I do have grapefruit juice, so I'm using that. Since I don't have grapefruit soda, I'll be adding a little simple syrup to bring a bit of sweetness to the drink. Don't go overboard with it, though. Simple syrup is sugar dissolved into water. It's really easy to make, and it stores well. Finally, we're going to be adding some fresh squeezed lime juice. I'm going to be shaking this cocktail, but if you happen to be using grapefruit soda, save yourself the mess and stir everything together instead.
Again, thank you, Corey.
What's going on in the music selection?
It wasn't even it's not, the beverage wasn't even from the right hemisphere. I don't even understand what I'm not trying to restrict his creative expression. I want him to do, I would appreciate an explanation. It just seemed, he's just doing it to do it, and that's fine also. I wish I knew. It's just, I don't know. It's just, I don't know why it bothers me so. Next to the maritime. All right, well, this is actually a little alarming. We've had no report from Joanna, so currently we do have one of our reporters at large lost in the Annapolis area, possibly in a bay, possibly in a 5-star hotel, possibly eating crab cakes off the Pope's belly. This must be an edit issue. I don't know. Anyway, so hopefully, the science report. So we got a lot of reports that last time the music was kind of like, that's not very sciencey. Well, so we got a up it up, because science is exciting, isn't that right? All right, yeah, science. La 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 la, science take me seriously. What? What? All right. Filling Arctic with giant animals could slow climate change. In order to protect the Arctic from the ravages of climate change, a team of scientists has a bizarre plan. The idea, CBS News reports, is to fill the Arctic with hordes of grazing animals like reindeer and bison, which would help keep the permafrost frozen by trampling it. The trick, they say, could save 80% of the Arctic permafrost until the year 2100. Stomping ground. When snow falls in the Arctic, it actually serves as a layer of insulation between the soil and the more much frigid air above it, CBS reports. As climate change worsens, that insulation threatens to allow the soil temperature to rise to the point that the permafrost begins to thaw. That's where the animals come in. According to simulations published last month in the journal Nature, large herbivores not only dispense the snow insulation as they walk around, but also help stamp down, and compact the soil beneath them. Questions of feasibility plague the study, however. Unless the plan is to cover millions of square kilometers of horses, bisons, and reindeer, how could this possibly have any significant impact? Rick Thompson, a climate specialist at the International Arctic Research Center, told CBS. Thank you, Rick. I agree. A, first of all, that's a lot of animals. B, I've got some fucking serious moral issues sending a bunch of animals into the Arctic tundra to save my ass. I'm mostly a vegetarian to begin with, you know, just because I like Indian food. It's like, not like, yeah. Anyway. All right. We try to have a serious note to this show at some point. And that is the issue with people and the protesters and the masks and not wearing them and like the civil liberties. And I know, like, they have a really good point. But you know who else has a really good point? This guy. I'd wear a mask to protect that guy. Oh, and this guy? Oh, I would definitely protect that guy. I'd wear two masks. In fact, do I have a mask here? I don't know. I don't have a mask. Fuck it. I'm gonna tape my face to make sure this little piggy doesn't fucking get hurt. Whatever it takes, I'm gonna protect this pig just like I would protect the neighbor, my family member. And this cute owl, I wanna protect this. I'm gonna spit on this owl and give him some fucked up disease that's gonna kill him. Not gonna do it. So I'm gonna do this fuck. Why don't you just cover your fucking face more, okay? Thank you. Jeez, oh my god, is that a pot of roux? I thought they only existed in Australia. I don't know. Oh my god, it's so fucking cute. Is that one? Is it three? What are they sitting in? I don't know, guys. I know, weird. Anyway, cover your face, people! Fucking people not covering their face? What's up with that? Fucking like. It's not like I'm asking you, fucking like. It's really difficult. Just cover your face.